Hey guys, Taki here. This is an exciting day and I've got a packed video for all of you. I get super hyped whenever we get new processor drops for handhelds, and if you like PC gaming, AMD is pretty much the only game in town. Rest in peace, Intel. The new Phoenix mobile processors are about to make their way into laptops and gaming handhelds, and I've got one of them for a big showcase. This is really out of the ordinary that we have a complete handheld to look at with a new processor this early, so we'll talk more about why that's possible in just a bit. Before we do that, I do just want to say that this device is a prototype. More specifically, this is a DVT sample, and I don't usually make videos on devices that are at this stage of development because companies will typically only send out PVT or mass production devices for review. They do that because DVT devices can have hardware or software issues, and this device is no exception. It does have some bugs, but they don't impact anything that I want to do in this video. With that out of the way, let's jump into the specs of this beast. The A1 Pro comes with the Ryzen 7 7840U processor. This is a Zen 4 CPU with 8 cores and 16 threads. It has a whopping max boost clock of 5.1 GHz that should chew through high-end emulation. In this implementation with the current software, we have a TDP range of 7 watts up to 28 watts. The processor itself can go higher or lower than these values. For our GPU, we have an AMD Radeon 780M with 12 CUs and a max clock of 2.7 GHz. This is an RDNA 3 GPU, and it's one of the bigger changes in this new processor. Outside of this, we have 32GB of LPDDR5X 6400 RAM and quad channel, 2TB of PCIe 4.0 storage, an 8-inch 1280p display, and a 65Wh battery. So far, I've spent about 50 hours or so on the A1 Pro. If this design looks familiar to you, it's because it's almost exactly like the A1 model that the company sold last year with the 6800U processor. Part of the reason why companies like AOK and Ioneo will have handhelds right out the gate this time around is due to the fact that the 7840U uses the same socket as the 6800U. So if you've already gone through the work of building a handheld with a 6800U, it's really easy for you to reuse it with Phoenix, and that's what we see here. I never used the A1 model, but I have used other handhelds from the parent company of AOK, and this one is better than I thought it would be. Barring one or two things, I think this is a much better handheld than the 1X player models that I've reviewed. There are a few things that I like about this that I want to quickly go over. Everyone knows that RGB lights boost FPS by about 1-2% on average, and I like the ones that they added to the palm area. You can easily switch between different colors with a hotkey button, or you can change them in software. I also like the keyboard shortcut that we have on the right side. This is not that common on handhelds these days, and I like having a dedicated button. I also want to say that I like how plain this white model is. They have a blue color that looks better than this, but it has a bunch of gamer lines all over the front and some dumb messages on the screen that I don't really care for. Outside of this hardcore gamers tag on the top, this one is a lot better. But that's enough for now, let's head into the benchmarks. Whenever I get my hands on a new processor like this, I need to run it through a bunch of tests to find where its strengths and weaknesses are. We'll do a bunch of synthetic benchmarks before hopping over into some games. Let's start with 3DMark. I didn't want to go overboard with this, so I only tested 3 TDP levels, 10W, 15W, and 28W. At 10W TDP, we get 1139 for graphics and 3528 for CPU. 15W TDP, we get a big boost in performance. Our graphics score jumps to 2082 and our CPU goes to 6030. Just based on this test, this should put us above the Steam Deck at 15W TDP. And finally, at 28W TDP with turbo mode activated, we got a score of 2658 for graphics and 8696 for CPU. Using the same three levels, I also went ahead and ran the Geekbench 5 benchmark to map out our CPU performance. Once we collect the data and put it on a graph, this is what we get. As you can see, something is wrong with our single core performance. I don't know what is causing this, but I reran all of these tests with the power cable connected, and the performance appears as I would expect. After finding this, I reran the TimeSpy benchmark, but the results didn't change, so this is super strange. Now it's time to take a look at PC gaming performance with the new 7840U processor. I have a ton of games to showcase in this first video, so I might break these tests up into two sections with some of my impressions on different parts of this device in between. This section is going to be a mix of captured footage and live recordings. For our first game, we have God of War at 28W TDP. I have the resolution set to 1080p, and I'm using low settings with FSR set to quality. Using these settings, we can get an average of around 45-ish FPS in main areas, but in combat, this can go down to the mid-30s. Our next game is Skywalker Saga at 25 watts TDP. This time around, we're using high settings, but we're getting about the same performance as God of War. Next up, we have Hades. This is at 1080p with the TDP cap set to 15 watts, but it actually will only use 13 watts for this game. Here's another big game, Assassin's Creed Odyssey at 28 watt TDP. This time around, we're using 1200p to fill out our screen, and we're using low settings. Using these settings, we can get decent FPS as we run through the city, but we can't quite hit 60 FPS in any situation. We would need to drop the resolution down a bit to make that happen. When it comes to Spider-Man Remastered, we need to use at least 25 watt TDP to run the game at 1080p using my settings. Using these settings, we can get about 40 to 55 FPS depending on what we're doing in the city. Now, I do have this set at 25 watt TDP, but even if I put this at 28 watt TDP, it doesn't really improve things that much. I went with 25 watt because that gives us the best mix of performance per watt. Our next title is Final Fantasy VII Remake. We're getting decent FPS as we run through this main city. Once we get into combat, we get similar performance, but the FPS can dip down with more mobs on screen or as we use abilities. This is still great performance for a handheld. So long. Here's an older title, Metro Exodus, running at 1080p. Using these settings, we can't quite max this game out, even if we boosted the TDP up to 28 watts. Depending on where we are, we're going to be in the 40s to 50s. Cyberpunk 2077 was another big title that I wanted to test on the A1 Pro. At this point in the game, I was using 15 watt TDP since that was enough to get me 30 FPS indoors, and I thought that was going to be good enough later on. As I got outside, I needed to bump up the TDP to maintain decent FPS. And just to answer the question of does it run Crysis, yes it does. Here's Crysis 3 running at low settings. This is performing pretty well, but this is the second or third time that I ran through this level. Even with that being the case, the game can still stutter a bit, so I wouldn't say this is really a game that I would want to play on a handheld. Control is another big game that I wanted to test out. I started this off at 15 watt TDP, and the performance was pretty decent. As I moved further into the game, I needed to boost this up to 25 watt TDP, and that gave me over 60 FPS on average. Monster Hunter World is one of my favorite games, and it's one that I always test on handhelds like this. Here it is at 800p high settings, but we need to use 28 watt TDP to do this. I don't think that's a great trade-off, so I bumped this down to 15 watt TDP with low settings, and I'm able to get decent FPS at 1080p resolution. Before we move on to other stuff, I did want to test out the D-pad since that's a point of contention for many people, and it wasn't something that I needed to use that much during my initial testing. For this, I'm using dead cells at 1200p resolution. We need to set the TDP to 7 watts in order to get this game to run at 60 FPS locked. I want to share some of my impressions on this. I know that circle D-pads get a lot of hate, but I do think they can be done well. This one isn't great, but it's not terrible. I have used D-pads that are worse than this. Basically, there are two things about this that don't really help. The first is that the entire surface is very smooth, so it's not the best for grip. The second is the fact that they went with conductive rubber for this instead of using micro switches. Don't get me wrong, the thing completely works, and it actually works very well for fighting games, but it seems to be out of place. The conductive rubber also causes the D-pad to make a lot of noise as it comes up from a button press. If I were in charge of this product and I was limited in what I could do to improve this, I would add some sound dampening material around the perimeter to significantly cut down on the noise. It's a cheap fix that I've seen work before. The D-pad is a solid C-, but it's a lot better and more useful than standard ones that they've used in other handhelds. Since this device has a huge battery, I wanted to take a look at how long the battery lasts at 15 watt TDP. I picked this level because that's a point where a lot of games become playable without a lot of compromises. I'll run a standard game at 15 watt TDP and then I'll record a bunch of stats until the device dies. I will then record how long it takes for the device to fully recharge with the 65 watt charger that came with my unit. In the 15 watt charge drain test, the A1 Pro lasted for almost 2.5 hours, which is a ton of battery life for that level of performance. I ran the test until the device completely shut off, so the recharge time should represent our worst case scenario. Using the included charger, we got a total recharge time of just over 2 hours. While I was doing this test, I noticed some important things that I want to go over. This recharge time was done with the device powered off because that gave the highest peak power draw of 65 watts from the wall. When the device is powered on, this charging speed cuts in half. You also need to make sure that the device has good ventilation while it's charging because the battery can get warm. I had mine laying down on the floor and the charging cut out at one point until I repositioned it and it cooled off. In this section, I want to talk about the screen. I'm planning to benchmark this in just a second, but I want to share some of my thoughts based on using this for the last 3 days or so. I think the first thing that's going to be obvious to you, or probably clear to you from watching this footage, is that the screen does look pretty decent. The saturation is decent and the contrast ratio doesn't seem to be that bad. You can see that there is a decent difference between the darker areas in this picture and the brighter ones. If I had to pick one thing that leaves me wanting with this screen, it would be the maximum brightness level. It feels like this screen should be about 20% brighter than it is to meet my needs in brighter settings. That's half the picture though. On the other side of this, it has a decent minimum brightness level that's good for playing at night. Outside of these two things, I've also noticed that the screen doesn't generate a lot of heat. There are a lot of screens on the market that are better than this, but some of them come with the trade-off that they are a bit hotter than this one is. This one doesn't really have that problem, even when I'm gaming on it for hours. Anyway, let's look at the data. When it comes to the sRGB gamut coverage, we are at 100%. After switching over to the P3 color space, we get 87.3%. These are very good stats for a gaming handheld. Our contrast ratio is a bit on the low side, coming in at 1011 to 1, and our peak brightness is also a bit lower than the Steam Deck at 427 nits. Finally, our color temperature is a bit on the blue side with a measurement of over 8000 Kelvin. We can adjust this with the Radeon settings, but we'll lose some color accuracy, brightness, and our contrast ratio by doing so. Before we head back into the gaming performance tests, I want to talk about thermal performance. I have a couple of things that I've noticed so far while using this device. The first thing that I want to say is that this cooling system can handle the TDP range of this device very well. At 20 watt or 28 watt, the device doesn't really get that hot to hold. And the heat source that is here is pretty far away from where your hands are, so it doesn't feel uncomfortable to hold. That being said, there is one area that I think is lacking at this point, and it's the custom fan control. To illustrate this, I want to go over the settings that we have on this device at this point. Right now I have this game running at 7 watt TDP, and you can see that the CPU is at 46 Celsius. So that's not a bad thing. This is essentially running like an Android phone that's running some light applications. Now let's look at the fan controls. We have an automatic mode, and we have two customized profile options. If we look at the fan speed that's listed, it's pretty high for the amount of heat that our CPU is generating at this point. This speed will go all over the place when your TDP is this low. It does have the ability to go off at some points, and it probably would if I lifted this off the table, but it will only stay off for a bit before ramping right back up to 20% fan speed or so. Let's look at what we have for custom controls. You can see that I've made a profile here, and I've tried to basically not let the fan be used that much. The problem is that the lowest setting that we can use is 30% fan speed, which is way too high for something like 7 watt TDP. You probably only need 5% or 10% to be able to cool this occasionally. Editing this graph is also not the best, especially when you don't use a mouse. You can touch the points on the graph that you want to use, but it's difficult. If you mess up, you have to try and press the tiny point that you added by accident. But yeah, the impressions that I have of this fan is that it's too aggressive at this point. I hope that they improve the default fan curves or allow these custom profiles to be more reasonable. This processor can do a ton at under 10 watt TDP, and I would be willing to trade a quiet device for one that runs at, let's say, 60 Celsius or so. Moving back over to the games, we have Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles at 8 watts. When it comes to GTA 5, we only need 10 watts to run this game at 720p low settings. This gives us about 50 to 60 FPS on average. If we bump this up to 15 watts, we have a lot more headroom. Dragon's Dogma is an old favorite. Here it is at 20 watt TDP. I have the TDP capped at 20, but it actually won't go that high. Death Stranding is another good game to benchmark. Even with this high TDP, we cannot really max this title out with the 7840U using these settings. I got asked to test out Skyrim, so here it is at 15 watts. Just like other titles, this can go under 15 watts in some areas, but this gives us a rock solid average of 60 FPS. Elden Ring is another title that I like to benchmark on these devices. Here it is at 28 watts, medium settings. I had it at low settings before this, but I bumped it up to increase the demand for this video. We've only got a few games left. Here's Horizon Zero Dawn at 28 watt TDP using low settings with no FSR. If I enabled FSR, the game will run a bit better than this, but the footage doesn't look that good when it's captured. Our FPS is in the mid-30s using these settings, so we'd probably need to bump down the resolution, but I'm impressed by how well this game runs as we travel through the big city.
Said to meet him at the Sun Palace.
This game ran a bit slower than I thought it would based on the other Souls games that I was testing. At 28 watt TDP, we managed to hit 60 FPS in some areas, but it can dip down depending on how many mobs are on screen. This used to be a really demanding game, and it kind of still is. Here's Ark Survival Evolved. We're getting about 30 to 40 FPS in this first area by the water. And our last title for this video is Stray at 28 watt TDP. This game runs very well with medium settings. I played this a lot on the A1 Pro. One area where I expect the 7840U to shine is in emulation. This video is already getting kind of long, but I wanted to throw in a couple of games from various systems just to give you an idea of what this can do. Our first system is the original Xbox, and it runs very well on this device using the XMU emulator. Next up, we have Wii U emulation. This is a system that already ran very well on weaker AMD chips, so that performance naturally carries over to this one. Here's Mario Kart 8 with the CMU emulator. Xbox 360 is one of the bigger systems that I was excited to test. For our first title, we have Red Dead Redemption 1 with the latest Xenia Canary version.
Reporting a long time. Strange place for a decent fella to want to visit, if you don't mind, Miss Vance.
Who said I was a decent fella?
For our second title, we have Forza Horizon. Finally, we have PS3 emulation with God of War 3. Prior to recording this video, this game was running about 10 FPS higher than you see in these scenes, so I'm not really sure what's happening. It still runs very well. Anyway, that's going to wrap up things on this big first look at the A1 Pro. If you enjoyed this video, take a look at the video that I did on the unreleased Lenovo Legion Play. That was another DVT handheld like this one. Happy gaming, everyone. Taki out.